Okay, in this video we shall see a little bit on the algebra of vector fields and how one can define a Lie bracket for vector fields. And okay, so let's start, let's say, with an example, or let's fix some notation. So D01, we recall that the tangent bundle, so this is vector bundle, so the bundle projection is called pi, so it's a vector bundle. A section, or this means a smooth map x from M to Tm, such that if I compose it with the bundle projection, I get the identity on M is called a vector field. And we write Vm for the space of sections of the tangent bundle. So to distinguish it, we have these vector fields. Okay, and since Tm is a vector bundle, we can add and multiply in every fiber of the bundle. So we get a natural becomes a vector space with respect to the pointwise operations in the fibers. Or in other words, if I have x plus ry, so this should be a vector field. I want to define it at a point m, so I define it as x of m, so this is in the fiber over m, plus r times y of m. Again, this is in multiplication and addition is in the fiber over m, so this is all in tm m. So this makes sense and gives us a vector space structure on the vector fields, right? So they actually form a vector space. Okay. Before we continue to investigate this vector space, which we actually want to topologize, so let's study an easier example. Let's assume we have an open subset of a locally convex space E. Then the tangent bundle of U, we already know that this tangent bundle can be canonically identified with U times E. So a vector field on U is a smooth X from U to U times E with pi U composed with x is equal to the identity on U. However, what is this projection? This is just the projection onto the first component. Or in other words, this implies that we can write x as identity map in the first component, and then there's another smooth map xe we have in the second component. This xe is actually all we need to know about the vector field, so we can thus uniquely identify x with the smooth map xe. And so this is a smooth map from U with values in the locally convex space E. So if now m is a manifold, then the tangent bundle will in general not be as simple as before. However, if we give ourselves a chart phi u, we can trivialize in that chart, right? So we have so we obtain an analog of this mapping XE with respect to the chart we are working in. And how does this work? So if we take a smooth vector field X, vector field on M, then we can look at, so we sandwich the X with the chart in this matter. And what we get here, this is the identity on phi of u, and then we have a smooth map x phi sitting in here. And this obviously depends on the chart I have used, because it comes about from the sandwiching procedure with the tangent chart and the inverse of the chart. So we can thus define for every such chart the smooth map x phi. How do we define the x phi? Well, so this is phi inverse composed with x, and now we don't want the full tangent mapping here. So since this identity part does not is not of interest to us, and so what we do, we compose it with d phi. Recall what was this d phi. This is just the tangent map of phi, however, then composed with the projection onto the second component, or onto the vector component. This is exactly this guy here, right? So we call x phi the local representative of x with respect to the chart phi u. Okay, and now let us now topologize the vector fields. And in the end, it will turn out that this topology turns the vector fields into a locally convex topological vector space. So we pick an atlas A of M, whose charts we denote by phi, from u phi to v phi, and then they are contained in some locally convex space e phi, which may depend on phi. We declare a topology on Vm as the initial topology with respect to the map kappa. And what does this map kappa do? So it takes a vector field and sends it to the product. We take phi from A, we are sending it into the C infinity functions from V phi with values in E phi, and X goes, oops, I'll just write that below here. So X goes, X, send this to the family of local representatives X phi, phi in A. Okay, so this makes sense, is well defined, and obviously I need to so what is the topology on the right hand side? So where the factors on the right hand side carry the compact, open, see infinity topology. So this topology we understand, and then the product as always carries a product topology, and so this topology turns VM into a locally convex space. For this, we observe that since d phi is linear, we have kappa of x plus ry. If x and y are vector fields, r is a scalar again, so then this is x plus ry phi, and then we have all the phi in A. However, if we are looking at the local representatives and we exploit that the tangent map or the derivative component of the tangent map is linear, we get that this is x phi plus r y phi, phi in A, or in other words, this is kappa of x plus r kappa of y. So we see that actually the k, the kappa is not only a mapping, any mapping which gives us a topology on our set, but it's also linear. And with just a little bit of work exploiting that, the C infinity topology turns the C infinity functions into a locally convex space. So this means that VM is a locally convex space with respect to this initial topology. Okay, so far so good. Right. So now I'm skipping over over the definition of integral curves. So D0, 0, 4 was integral curves for vector fields. But so let's focus for the moment on algebraic properties. So we are en route to define the so-called Lie bracket of vector fields. And for this, we need some more concepts. So we need definition. If F from a manifold M to a manifold N is smooth, we call a vector field in Vm and a vector field in Vn F related if Y composed with F is equal to TF composed with X. Okay, and note that a priori, if we have a smooth map and a vector field on N or M, there's no reason why we should find a related vector field on the other manifold. So in general, this is a special property, and we shall exploit this. So how do we do this? Let's first study this property a little bit more. So if M is a manifold with atlas A and x phi, phi in A, a family of smooth maps. So x phi should be smooth mappings from the codomain of the chart into the model space at which the chart maps, such that every pair x phi x psi is psi composed with phi, so change of inverse, so change of chart related on the overlap phi of u phi intersect with u psi, then there is a unique vector field x in VM whose local representatives coincide with the x phi. So what the upshot of this lemma is, if we have an atlas and a family of compatible smooth maps, compatible in the way that they're related by the change of charts, then we can build a vector field from these pieces. And the proof is as you would expect. So we have already pieces which are related. So we define now a smooth mapping from M to Tm via the following. So if we take a point P, then we send it to T phi inverse of phi of P. So in the first component, not much is happening. And then we take X phi of P, right? So for P in the chart domain, of course. Okay. And since X phi and X psi are related by the change of charts, on the overlap U phi disagrees U psi, or actually I need to say to bracket this with the vector field, the map X is well defined. Yeah, so this makes sense. So an easy computation shows that this is well defined, and by construction X is smooth and a vector field. So if you compose it with the multiplication with the bundle projection, then we get the identity. Okay, and so now we want to use these this local approach to construct a Lie bracket. So for X, Y, vector fields on U, where U is an open subset of E, we write XE dot YE of a point Z. So we define this as the derivative of Y composed with XE at P. And the idea is, so this is something like the derivative of y in the direction of x. I mean, actually, what I should have written here is, there's an e too much. So, or in other words, this is, of course, dye of z xe of z. So this is the derivative of y at the point z in the direction given by xe. And so we define a bracket, which would turn out to be the Lie bracket. By the following formula. So we bracket x with y. So this is defined as x dot y minus y dot x for x and y smooth functions on the open set U with values in E. Okay, so we have this local formula. So this one here is a local formula for the bracket. And obviously, I mean, we didn't want to define a bracket of smooth functions on open subsets of a vector space, but we wanted We wanted to define a Lie bracket of vector fields. And for this, we need to basically first work in charts. So we define first a bracket of the local local representatives, and then we use the lemma DIN 06, which allows us to glue back together these things if we can show that it's related. And so basically the idea is first to go local, localize everything in charts, construct the bracket, and see that the resulting family is again compatible with respect to this relatedness notions. And that this is the case we will do, we will see in the following lemma, which is unfortunately a tedious computation, but okay, there's not much else we can do about this. So if we have an open subset in E and an open subset in F, so both are locally convex spaces. All right. And let's assume we have F smooth mapping from U, which takes values in V. And we have X1, X2, two smooth mappings from U to E, and Y1, Y2, two smooth mappings from V to F. And we assume finally that Xi is F related to Yi. Then the bracket of X1 with X2 is F related to the bracket of Y1 with Y2. So the whole point of the exercise is we want to see that F relatedness is something which is inherited by the bracket of two local representatives. So in other words, if we start off with the local representatives of two vector fields, then we can construct the brackets. And since the local representatives are F or are change of chart related, this relatedness condition is inherited by the bracket. And okay, so we need to prove this, and unfortunately this is a bit tedious. So however, fortunately, I mean, what will happen here? So when we go back a little bit to this yellow formula, we see that we have a derivative cropping up here, and we need to use relatedness. So relatedness is also a derivative condition. So we in the relatedness condition, which we have up here above, so in the relatedness condition, we have the tangent mapping cropping up, right? And so we have the tangent mapping, and we are taking another derivative. So this means we in the proof with second derivatives will crop up. And so we have to use the chain rule. And we have a statement which was recorded in 1.7, which allows us to deal with a derivative of another derivative function. So in this statement we want is the following relation. So we have df at x, and we apply it to dxi of x in the direction of v. So then it turns out by inserting the relatedness condition using the chain rule, so this d of yi applied to f of x, and then we are going here in the direction of df of x at v minus d squared f x xi of x and v. So we have two arguments here. So this holds for I equal to 1 and 2, and xv in u times e. So let's call this relation here d1. Okay. Okay, using this together with relatedness, yields now the following. So we need to understand what happens if we apply df at a point x to the bracket of x1 and x2, also evaluated at this point x. There we are just inserting the definition and use linearity of the derivative in the second component. So we know that in this component here, df is linear, so we can pluck apart at the difference. So this gives us df of x dx2 x in the derivative x1 x minus df x at dx1 in the derivative x in the direction of x2 x. So, and now we apply our formula d1 here and just look at what is happening. So this is d, so we apply d1, so this is dy2 at the point f of x in the direction df of x x1 x minus d squared f x x2 x x1 x. All right, so minus dy1 f of x df x x2 x plus d squared f x x1 x x2 x. All right, so let's tidy up this mess. First of all, let's notice two things. So we have here two second derivatives which are of f, which are almost the same, except that we have only switched the order of the arguments in the second and third space. However, we know that, or by assumption, the f is smooth, and we can apply the we can apply Schwarz theorem. So what Schwarz theorem says for smooth mappings in the is that the second derivative is symmetric in the derivative arguments. This cancels. Okay, and now we are just left with dy2 and dy1 evaluated at some points. And here we can exploit the relatedness condition. So we know that x1 is f related to y1. So this is actually y1 at f of x. And similarly, the second one downstairs here. So this is y2 at f of x. So and in the end, if we write out everything we have, so this is dy2 at f of x in the direction y1 at f of x minus dy1 at f of x derivative in the direction y2 at f of x. Or in other words, this is the bracket of y1 with y2 evaluated at the point f of x. And this shows exactly the relatedness condition. So yeah, I should have written by Schwarz theorem. So in the end, this is a lengthy calculation. However, it shows that relatedness is inherited by at least these local representatives of the Lie algebra, of the Lie bracket. And in the next lecture, we will use this property to actually lift this Lie bracket to the space of vector fields.